Thank you, Peg, and everyone who's here. I love coming to this event. It is amazing. And Peg, I mean, whether you love it or not. Also, I noticed that there's a little sheet that came along, and you can vote for people you'd like to watch. And my name is still on that sheet, so it's right here, Toni Piccinini. So my book is right here, which makes a terrific holiday gift for all those moms on your list. It's about my realization. I am blessed to have three children. The realization when my oldest was starting her senior year of high school, everything was the last time we would be this family. And I was like, what the hell is that all about? It was all over. So I went through the year teaching cooking classes, and those are in here, and there's recipes. I'm quite a saleswoman tonight. But what I'm going to read from tonight is the chapter called Nothing Says It's Over Like a Dead Dog. I know. Nothing says it's over like a dead dog. The summer before Paige left for college, Indy, our dog, stopped eating. I'm thinking he's giving me shit because I bought some sale chow at the Safeway. One day he's out walking with Mary and the dog stealer. The next, he's in repose on the porch, breathing hard, with an untouched bowl of kibble sitting next to his empty bowl of water. Over the years, he and I had come to an understanding. By the time my first goodbye year kicked in, I was totally tired of seeing his furry, lazy ass hanging out all day with the hangdog, "When are you gonna walk me?" look on his face. I'm like, "You're a dog. Go run after a squirrel. We live in paradise. Just watch out for the Sutton kid speeding BMW on the Prospect Loop." I think I was starting to push against the structures of mommy land. Indy and I needed to design a new alliance. I watched my neighbor moms getting their shoulders pulled out of joint, resisting the force of their canine's natural impulse to run free. For me, it felt like time to let go. I had just gotten so tired of my purpose, thankless caregiving. So, poor Indy, or lucky Indy, depending on your perspective, embodied the toll that my years of being responsible for everyone else and my fear of what the future held for me had taken on my identity as mother. I didn't like this new phase of mothering. I wasn't ready to give up on the boys. It was probably against the law. So since I couldn't give up on the dogs, I gave up on my dog. I gave up on controlling my dog. Indy, dude, you are no longer one more thing I have to be responsible for and guilty about. You want to be on your own? Clearly you hate the leash. Was that you who didn't come the other day when I called? Okay, have at it. See you for dinner. He'd scratch at the door. I'd let him out. The first couple of times, he slunk off, looking over his shoulder like he was getting away with something, as if he could pull something over on me. But after a couple of days, he'd head out like all the husbands in the neighborhood, off to their normal jobs. But it wasn't normal. A dog walking alone? Heavens to Murgatroyd. He was a free man during the day, but he needed to be home for dinner, and he got it. As I said, we'd come to an understanding. He'd spend his day cruising the hood, going on walks with other dog walkers, and just being a dog. I don't really know what the hell he did all day. This struck some of my neighbors as a form of neglect. "Oh, hello," a voice panted into the kitchen phone. "I have your dog. Then the helpful citizen with the busy schedule offered to sacrifice a few minutes to wait until I came around to fetch him. I did it a couple of times. It was the most expedient path. But once it became a regular occurrence with new neighbor Marion, it became clear to me that she was in the rescue business. Just let him go, I told her. He'll find his way home. Oh, I could never do that. I'll walk him over, said the passive-aggressive, judgmental biatch. I mean, fellow mom. And that's how it started. Indy would head out to Marion's house, spend the day, walk around tethered to her extra leash, and we dropped off for dinner. One day, I ran into them at the gas station. He's in the back of her SUV with her bling dog, Baxter, trying to act invisible. Like your teenager, pretending that he doesn't know you when by chance you both attend the same event. I've had dogs since I was a pup. I know dogs. Dogs are crazy about me because they sense a kindred spirit. I can tell you one thing, if they could talk, they say, let me take my chances. They're not stupid and they're not babies. They'd say, do you have any idea how irritating this name tag and license are jingling around my neck like a high school girl's charm bracelet? You know, we're known for our excellent hearing, day in and day out, not that I get out that much. I have to deal with chimes 2 inches from my sensitive ears. I know, brother. The week before I left for college, Funky, our family mutt, knew something was up. I was spending more time in my room, deciding what I was going to take and what I was going to leave behind. He was hanging out a little closer to me. I'm going to college, Funky. Am I coming? Nope, just me, I said. He was doing that go around 3 times move like his ancient ancestors before he settled into my covers. He crossed his paws and rested his alligator face on top of them. What are you gonna do when I'm gone? I asked him. Chase chickens, bark up the wrong trees, smell stuff, he said, lifting an ear. And I still have the paper out. Who are you gonna sleep with? Louie, probably, he said. Before he remembered, he had balls to lick. Funky kept busy. I respected that about him. The family dog is a marker of time, just like the marks on the kitchen wall that inch up every year, showing your children's height. We got Indy when the kids weren't more than puppies themselves. On a sunny Sunday, the 5 of us climbed into the trooper, drove to the shelter looking for a replacement cat, and came home with an 85-pound sort of kind of black Labrador. Oh, the walks and baths he would enjoy with the kids. How they loved their dog. How I loved the idea of 3 kids and a big slobbering dog. It was during the acquisition phase of parenting. Life was huge and it was great. Of course, no surprise, the kids lost interest and I, like all the moms of all time, had to take over his care. I called his vet's office and told them about Indy's lack of appetite. They said, come right over. Hey, old boy, Dr. Opie said to Indy while rubbing the doggy G-spots behind his ears. We'll do some tests. He's probably fine. I'll call you in a couple hours, he said to me. My phone rang just as I got home from the 15-minute drive. You can come by and get Indy. I've given him something to keep him comfortable, but I wouldn't wait too long, not past Monday. It was Friday. Too long for what? He's got cancer, loaded, stomach, liver. He's a stoic old boy. But these things go fast. What things go fast? Life. By Sunday morning, I couldn't stand it. I could tell he was in too much pain. And still, when I called him to get in the trooper, he stood up, wagged his tail, and got in the back seat with the kids, just like he had 10 years before. The 5 of us said goodbye to Indy in a white beadboard-covered room that looked a lot like our kitchen. His shoulders relaxed when Dr. Opie injected the first shot, and he smiled his doggy smile on top of a thick carpet embroidered with bones, and then he was gone. Was I sad? Yes, intensely. More than that, I felt guilty for not having loved him enough, and this pain was my punishment. Was I entitled to my grief, since I clearly and visibly didn't give a rat's ass about his safety? I let him off the leash. But wait a tick. Wasn't freedom the real market of love? Hey, I read The Prophet in high school. Jonathan Livingston Seagull would agree. Indy wasn't hit by a car or eaten by a bear. He was 91 in people years. He had a good life, his obituary would say. Yet Indy's departure hung over our last August as a family, like a ghost of what was and would never be again. Thank you.